under this year's wonders.
One of the topics which came under scrutiny. Ton giant is airborne.
It was front page news
from the scene of Britain's worst train disaster. Had she fallen, she was expected to be able to fly 9 feet. When he was a soldier in Germany, he met Priscilla Goldie.
We are all part of history. Wherever we are and whatever we're doing, world events shape our memories. And for most of the 20th century, those events were filmed and explained by PATHÉ. PATHÉ News captured history in motion, creating a living chronicle of a turbulent century. Tension between the United States and the Soviet Union, long in evidence throughout the 50s, began to become more and more worrying during 1960. All over the world, trouble spots flared up and few could see an end to many localized conflicts. In Algeria, France seemed to be on the brink of civil war. In the Congo, Belgium beat a hasty retreat from its colonial past, leaving bloodshed in its wake. In South Africa, the black majority began to fight the cruelties of apartheid. And in Berlin, thousands of refugees sought freedom from state communism. But 1960 was dominated by superpower politics. On May the 1st, an American spy plane known as a U-2 was shot down over Soviet territory, and the pilot, Gary Powers, was taken prisoner. U-2 flights had been taking place for about 3 years, but Khrushchev decided to use the incident to embarrass the Americans. He demanded an apology from President Eisenhower while they were at a summit meeting in Paris. Eisenhower refused, countering that the Russians were spying on the U.S. Khrushchev stormed out and the summit ended in disarray. Powers was put on trial and sentenced to 10 years in a Soviet jail. He would only spend 2 years behind bars. In 1962, he was swapped for a Russian spy captured by the Americans. Khrushchev had become supreme leader of the Soviet Union in 1958, after 5 years as a prominent member of the Russian Politburo. The son of a Ukrainian miner and an ex-coalface worker himself, Khrushchev was famous for his abrasive style. During 1960, he became notorious for heckling speakers and banging his shoe at the United Nations. Khrushchev was also known as a brave politician. In 1956, he had denounced Stalin and survived with his position enhanced. The U-2 incident was another example of his brinkmanship. The U-2 was also used by an aspiring American politician to embarrass Eisenhower. John F. Kennedy set out to prove that America's intelligence and diplomatic services were badly run. Kennedy, a 43-year-old senator from Massachusetts, took the Democratic nomination. In the November election, he beat Richard Nixon by only 100,000 votes. 1960 ended with a young man at the helm of a superpower, a man who promised a new frontier for the American people, a man who would have to deal with a divided country and an uneasy world.
Who'd have thought, remembering Pearl Harbor, that a Washington crowd would ever welcome a Japanese prime minister? But here it was, Premier Kishi being greeted by Secretary Herta and Vice President Nixon. He'd come to renew a treaty between his own country and America, but before he left Japan, 700 students rioted in an attempt to stop him taking off. They even went to the length of barricading the airport stairs. Extreme left-wingers, the students believe an alliance with the states may involve Japan in war if ever things flare up between China and America. It shows the change that's come over the Japs since the days when they couldn't have enough war. It was a bonny fight, and 78 were arrested. Needless to say, they didn't prevent the Premier taking off. It died suddenly, soon after midnight. Agadir, a fair city, became in seconds a total ruin. It was as though, said one observer, it had been trodden on by an inconceivably gigantic foot. Towards midnight, an unnatural stillness was shattered by a rending crash. The hard earth split into great fissures. Where now they searched for bodies, large buildings crumbled, subsided into dusty heaps. Devastation on a ghastly scale was wrought in less than half a minute. As As these films were made, more than 2,000 bodies had been dug out. Perhaps 3,000 are still buried there. And there they may remain, for Agadir is to be sealed off in precaution against the risk of plague. Tourists who survived tell of the early terror giving place to horror when it was realized what had happened. They say dogs howled for hours in that nerve-wracking early morning before it was light. And this was Agadir when it had been all but obliterated by the hand of nature. For the care of the injured, many of them toddlers who now have no parents, France, America, and Britain have rushed aid. Neighboring countries are still stunned, contemplating one of the biggest natural disasters in modern times. The 3 million people of Brazil's capital gave a welcome of the famous New York type to President Eisenhower. If some of the places visited on his South American tour have rather restrained their greeting, there was no doubt at all that Rio at this time was 100% pro-Ike. The Avenida Rio Branco tried to outdo Broadway itself. There was a blizzard of ticker tape. Just as Khrushchev is getting all the support he can marshal in Asia to add weight to his views at the summit conference, so Eisenhower is anxious to have South America on his side. Good luck to him. The Western world must be united to confront the communists. The Indian president's bodyguard escorted President Nasser from the airport when he began his 13-day visit to the subcontinent. President Prasad and Mr. Nehru met their distinguished guest. The welcoming crowd was estimated at more than 100,000. The mayor of New Delhi presented President Nasser with examples of Indian handicrafts. The Egyptian ruler said that friendship between India and the Arab world was older than history. A state occasion at the Paris Opera. And could there be anywhere two men more utterly different than Khrushchev and De Gaulle? On the whole, Kay has had a friendly welcome by the French. And as he and President De Gaulle have one thing in common, that they can both be a bit on the inflexible side, they understand each other and get along pretty well. When it came to the reception and banquet in Mr. Kay's honor, Geiger counters were run over the food, as they couldn't let him have anything radioactive. In the south, the Russian leader was shown the pumping station at Pishkru, used in the irrigation of a large area once barren. Madame Khrushchev has gone down very well everywhere. Kay was rather embarrassingly presented with a lamb, but was equal to the occasion. He couldn't refuse a symbol of peace. As well as his wife, he had his daughters with him, a family touch which seemed to appeal to the French. Nearby, at the ancient city of Nîmes, there was a dancing display in the Roman amphitheater, which is nearly 2,000 years old. It made a welcome break in Khrushchev's very crowded program, while France exploded another bomb. A Comet 4B arrived at Moscow Airport from London, inaugurating the new service between the two capitals. The pipers played to strengthen Anglo-Russian friendship. We hope somebody told the Russians, or they might have got a different idea. Why pipers? Because the chairman of the BEA, Lord Douglas, added weight to the occasion by making the trip himself, and he's a Scot. The other day, folks living near London Airport complained to him about the noise of comets. Now Moscow's getting a bit of it. The comet will make two trips a week, carrying 86 passengers in 3.5 hours, half the previous flying time. Congolese troops patrol the empty streets of Leopoldville, where there is nothing to be seen but the aftermath of violence. Violence which can break out again at any moment in the strange mixture of rejoicing and tragedy that is the Congo today. Excited Congolese hail the leaders of their young but troubled republic. Prime Minister Lumumba and President Kasavubu. Meanwhile, at Stanleyville, Ghana troops of the United Nations force arrive by plane for the very tricky task of restoring and maintaining order in this vast heart of Africa. For tempers are still at fever pitch, and the slightest incident in the streets can, without warning, flare up into conflict. Belgian paratroops are still in Leopoldville, trying to protect their own people against the bitter hostility of the Congolese, who have one slogan: there will be no peace until the Belgians have gone. In such an atmosphere, Britain's General Alexander and his United Nations detachment have a difficult enough job. But everyone welcomes them and waits anxiously for more to arrive. The Belgian units are leaving as fast as the United Nations troops come in, taking with them memories they will not forget in a hurry of the fellow countrymen they came to protect, who are still streaming out of the Congo with little more than their lives. Whether the blame lies with African recklessness or with Belgian folly or both, the sooner the United Nations is in control, the better for the Congo and the world. Polaris, the missile that's fired from underwater, wonder weapon of even this miracle age. Atomic submarine Washington put to sea with two Polaris aboard, ready for firing test. Washington is equipped to carry 16 missiles. Now her crew are about to make naval history, all set for the dramatic countdown 50 feet below surface. And there she goes. Success at the first attempt. In real war, the submarine could fire all the 16 she would have aboard inside 15 minutes. And up comes the second one. Both missiles hit targets 1,100 miles away. Congratulations were sent on behalf of the whole nation by President Eisenhower.
Moscow's Hall of Columns was packed for the most dramatic trial that even Russia has staged for many years. Francis Gary Powers, U.S. pilot of the U-2 espionage plane, had pleaded guilty and could only hope that the sentence passed by the three judges, Lieutenant General Boris Adebsky presiding, would be lenient. As was expected, Prosecutor Rudenko did not ask for the death penalty. Even so, Powers could have got 15 years. The best that Defense Counsel Mikhail Grinev could expect for his client was a somewhat lighter sentence. Powers' mother, father, and wife, even earlier in the trial, were tragic figures. Against Powers, there was little hate at the end. Russia directed her venomous attack largely against America itself, for all the world as if Soviet spies were not in every Western country. Powers got 10 years. In Washington, President Eisenhower was asked by pressmen about the charge that America herself had been on trial.
You're trying to say that they are condemning the United States in the whole before world opinion. Well, I think they have no case whatsoever. The number of spies that we have caught, and in the cases of bribery and subversion, which have been proved all over the world, gives a denies any validity whatsoever, this kind of a charge.
New York presented its worst appearance to Khrushchev. The Russian liner Baltico was greeted by hostile crowds as it tied up at the dilapidated Pier 73, known to locals as the garbage dump. However, Cave put a cheery face on it, as if it were the red carpet treatment he's used to. And despite the downpour coming through the roof, he read his speech, though nobody but his own entourage understood a word. Then he was whisked away to the headquarters of the Soviet delegation. Of Swiss Air brought two more communists, President Novotny of Czechoslovakia and Polish leader Gomulka. But the real show was reserved not for Gomulka, but for the Cuban leader, irrepressible Fidel Castro. He got a great reception, there being thousands of Cuban sympathizers in New York. As usual, Castro was full of confidence. Later on, he and his delegation walked out of their hotel, claiming they were being overcharged. The hotel wept no tear. Ukrainian refugees joined the anti-Khrushchev demonstrators, but the real drama was to be enacted at the United Nations. A sobering thought. For the first time for days, there was a feeling of hope in the General Assembly. Only Khrushchev and his servants were silent as Mr. McMillan made his way to the rostrum. Here, everyone felt, was a man of real leadership stature in the free world. It was to the Russians that the Prime Minister largely addressed himself.
this 15th Assembly of the United Nations must be of great significance in world affairs. And indeed, never since its foundation has one of our sessions been attended by so many international figures or commanded such wide public attention. Its influence is continually growing. Like all organizations, it can no doubt be improved. The President of the United States made certain suggestions for this purpose, which I greatly welcome. The Soviet proposal, if I may say so, seems calculated to have the opposite effect, for it would extend the veto, with all its embarrassments, into the realm of the Secretariat. As for the Secretary General, I would like to associate myself and my country with the wide expression of confidence in his energy, resourcefulness, and above all, integrity.
Khrushchev violently disagreed.
Mr. Khrushchev has said once more in this meeting, and made it the main reason for his of the vital need of world disarmament. We need to work patiently and sincerely. But all the time we need to remember that the hopes of millions of people are fixed upon us in this assembly. And for their sake, we must not fail.
Khrushchev and co., looking rather glum, very much in the minority. Picture of a man on top of the world. 43, U.S. president, pretty wife, lovely daughter. What more could any man wish? Jack Kennedy was born into a rich family whose fortunes were built up in the land of opportunity. But 110 years ago, his great-great-grandfather lived outside New Ross, Duncanstown, Ireland. Starvation faced him in his tiny farm cottage, and he emigrated to America. Josephine Ryan, Jack's cousin, lives close by. New Ross was excited when Jack was elected. Where are they off to? Maybe emigrating too to try their luck. The youngest ever president won't take office till January, but his election has been a tonic to America. He promises the new policy that will put the United States back into world leadership.
I ask your help in this effort. And I can assure you that every degree of mind and spirit that I possess will be devoted to the long-range interests of the United States and to the cause of freedom around the world. So now my wife and I prepare for a new administration and for a new baby. Thank you.
Harold Macmillan had become one of the most popular prime ministers of the century. He took over from a frail Anthony Eden after the Suez Crisis in 1956 and was soon able to proclaim that the country had never had it so good. In 1959, he increased the Conservative majority in Parliament with a third successive Tory win over Labour. 1960 saw Macmillan make his mark on the world stage. He made a long tour of the African continent, and in South Africa, he made his famous and prophetic Winds of Change speech when he pointed out that the tide of history was moving towards independence and nationalism in Africa, and that colonial powers could not survive long. The South African whites didn't like Macmillan's message. Out on the streets, they were facing growing unrest from the black majority. 1960 was the year in which 53 demonstrators were gunned down by the South African police at Sharpeville. Britain lost a political giant during 1960, Nye Rhenbellin. Nye was the son of a miner from Tredegar in Wales. And after leaving school at 13, he worked at the coalface until his successful union activities catapulted him into national politics. 1929 saw him enter Parliament, and he rose rapidly within the party. Famed for his skillful speeches and sharp tongue, Bevan once described the Tories as lower than vermin. Bevan's greatest achievement was the National Health Service, which he set up in 1948. During 1960, Bevan was deputy leader of the Labour Party and died as the party tried to come to terms with its third election defeat. Hugh Gaitskell, Labour's leader, attempted to change and modernise party policy, but he was fiercely resisted. Britain's mood seemed generally optimistic, though economic worries surfaced as the government attempted a credit squeeze to try and beat inflation. A
a mere 20-odd miles to go, and the amazing Dr. Babs would reach her goal, Land's End. 1,028 miles spread over 23 days, and all done on salad, grapefruit, cream, bananas, fruit juices, honey, and that great drink, hot water. Dr. Barbara set out to prove that that's the diet if you want to be healthy and energetic, as undoubtedly she must be. But what's John O'Groats to Land's End? Just a stroll to Barbara. With short rests and a bite now and then, she's going to walk across America, three times the distance. That evening, Penzance gave her a heroine's welcome. All the town turned out in Barbara's honor. The mayor himself received her at the town hall. Dr. Babs was easily the most popular person Penzance ever had at this time of the year. Naturally, she was a bit peckish. They couldn't keep her away from that orange juice. After that, there was the Distinguished Visitors Book. But of course, Barbara couldn't stay long. She was off again on the very last lap of all. Land's End next stop. We all laugh at her diet as we enjoy our steak and boiled puddings to follow. But Dr. Babs is no theorist. She put her beliefs into practice and achieved more hard-slogging physical effort than many a trained athlete. Well, here she was, Land's End at last, greeted by the West Penneth Council chairman. It was only 11:25, more than half an hour to spare.
When the West Rietfontein gold mine was visited by Mr. McMillan, the president of the Chamber of Mines jokingly said the premier came as representing the majority shareholders. It's a fact that British investment in the vast gold mining industry of the Rand is far and away the biggest in the world. So naturally, Mac went down to inspect the property, descending 4,000 feet. Mr. McMillan also inspected the smelting furnaces. He did more. He lent a hand with the crucible, pouring the precious metal into the molds. You can't get away from gold in this part of the world, so that doesn't mean it's there for the asking. That pyramid of gold bars, each worth £10,000, would make anyone a millionaire. Then on to Swaziland, and the warmest-hearted and most colourful welcome of the Premier's tour so far. Top-hatted Paramount Chief Sobhuza escorted his guest down the lines of Swazi warriors. Swaziland, though geographically in the heart of the Union of South Africa, is a British protectorate, home of a quarter of a million people. The shield, spear and stick presented to him will be three of the Premier's most treasured souvenirs of his African tour. Marcia Roberts and Michael Kelly had a real cool idea. A hairdo for Easter. Better than that, twin hairdos, both alike. Just the thing for a couple of cats. The place these two characters went to caters for exactly that. Dressing the crops like crazy. Sort of place that gives new heads for Teds. Girls like boys, boys like girls. Both the squares think like nothing on earth. Okay, man, shoot with that crazy wind machine. Cyril certainly is the most in this business. What a stylist. A touch of the silver spray and you're king of the coffee bar. The maestro was lost in admiration of his handiwork. Gassing about kings, how about queens? 1960 version, silver threads among the gold. You know, all this talk about sex equality has clean gone to their heads. Her Majesty led her people in Great Britain's reception of an old and tried friend, the President of Gold. As the train from Gatwick Airport drew into Victoria, the royal family, cabinet ministers and other notables waited to bid most hearty welcome to the head of the French state, Charles de Gaulle. Almost 20 years ago, he came to London, his beloved France defeated, to raise the standard of resistance. He came now as president of a resurgent nation upon which he has conferred political stability, a blessing denied it for more than 40 years. That he should have done so mainly by force of character and an integrity unique in French governing circles is the political miracle of our time. When the president had greeted all the members of the royal family present, Her Majesty presented the Prime Minister, his colleagues, and others of distinction assembled in de Gaulle's honor. Some of the ministers have been to France to meet him, but since June 1944, he has not been to England. It is said he once vowed not to come back here except as French head of state. The visitor was deeply moved. He was renewing acquaintance with the city of his four-year exile, the London where he bargained for recognition when he had no asset except burning faith. Into Buckingham Palace, a state visitor drove President de Gaulle. It was the Queen's first appearance in public since the birth of Prince Andrew.
Stanley Wilson, £100,000 pools winner, was back home with wife, children and in-laws. And in Hull, he was bigger news in the fish war. One-month-old baby Alan was the only calm one. At the other end of the family, George and Alice Stevens were overjoyed that £100,000 check is going to change all their lives. Stanley's boss welcomed the lucky 40-year-old joiner, and all his workmates gave him a pat on the back. Stan earned about £12 a week here, but the next item was to adjourn to the local for drinks all round. It was fabulous. He got 24 points and £100,000 for a penny. That's the way to invest money. Win the pools, and the government can squeeze credit till they're blue in the face.
For which thousands outside the Abbey had waited several hours, had now arrived. To the west door came the glass coach bearing Her Royal Highness the Bride. People near had their first glimpse of the wedding gown. It was perhaps surprising in its simplicity. This was a tense moment for the Queen, Queen Mother, and bridegroom. Privileged to be in the Abbey, remarked the quite astonishing beauty of the princess, radiant in her happiness as never before. The Archbishop of Canterbury waited to receive the bride and groom as they approached the faldstools.
Margaret Rose, wilt thou have this man to thy wedded husband, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony? Wilt thou obey him and serve him, love, honor, and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all other, keep thee only unto him so long as ye both shall live?
I will.
Those whom God hath joined together, let no man put asunder.
They were now married and made their way to the chapel to sign the registers. The bride and bridegroom now reappeared before the vast congregation.
Thank you.
The 50 minutes magical solemnity of the marriage service was over. By the west door, the princess and her husband emerged into the outer world, which they would now walk together, joined in holy matrimony. To the little bridesmaids, there was an affectionate wave. Then the waiting thousands really let themselves go. At last, they saw Princess Margaret as a wife.
The first object at Windscale, Cumberland, is the 135-foot diameter steel casing of the new type gas-cooled reactor. The reactor vessel will contain the graphite core and fuel elements loaded through stubs in the dome of the vessel. The intense heat generated will be used to make steam through the boiler tubes, just as is done by coal or oil in the pre-atomic power station. Four heat exchangers, each made in three sections, were brought to the site to be put into the reactor. That's putting it in very simple terms, but it took a lot of difficult manipulating to accomplish it. This advanced gas-cooled reactor is expected to be generating electricity by October next year. Being enclosed in steel, it will not be dangerous to the neighborhood if a radioactive leak occurs. Hence, it will be safe to build similar reactors near the built-up areas needing electricity. They won't have to be in the wilderness, miles from anywhere. A big step in the right direction.
One of our cameramen went behind the scenes to see what the Metropolitan Police have up their sleeve. This fine body of 50-year-olds, that's the average age, are the first of the new traffic wardens in training to keep the traffic flowing. Mostly former servicemen, they soon finish their basic training. How can we prevent the ever-increasing traffic halting into one big jam? Parking meters in the city of Westminster have done something, but there are still scores of streets and squares being turned into unofficial car parks. But what can you do? You've got to park somewhere. All right, but not in the wrong places, says Scotland Yard. So, from now on, the traffic wardens will see that parking meter rules are observed, as well as informing motorists where they can park and coming down on those who do so in forbidden spots. And it's all going to be done courteously. No slanging matches. Just say, what awful weather we're having, sir, and fine him £2. Here's a car that's overstayed its time. So take the number, out with the fine book. And when the driver comes back, he gets a friendly intimation that he must send the money by post. Parking penalties remain, but other offences carry a fine of £2. Having thoroughly filmed it all, our cameraman went back to his car, his service to the community performed. Well, there's gratitude for you. From the Bank Station in the heart of the City of London, it's always been a rush hour nightmare getting to Waterloo at night, and worse still, the other way in the morning. So a big welcome to the Travelator. At long last, it's the end of the drain. The old tunnel has made its Waterloo. Pity somebody didn't tell this old boy. Sir Philip Water, Chairman, Southern Region, British Railways, welcomed the Lord Mayor, Sir Edmund Stockdale, to the official opening of the Travelator. For British Railways, it was the fulfillment of a long-standing ambition. The moving platform replacing that dreadful old tunnel. London's first citizen and Sir Philip led the first passengers on the Travelator. It is a platform, not like the escalator, a moving stairway. Up or down the almost 100-yard-long Travelator, driven by two 85-horsepower motors, more than 13,000 passengers will be conveyed in the peak hour. The speed, 60 yards a minute. 488 segments of special aluminium make up the moving platform. It has taken 3 years to construct. A few hours after the opening, in its first rush hour, the Travelator was a big success. A milestone in naval history was passed at Barrow-in-Furness. The thousands making their way to the shipyard were in at the berth of Britain's first nuclear submarine. With rain threatening, umbrellas for the royal party were in good supply. For this, very properly, was a royal occasion. Fittingly, too, it was Trafalgar Day, and the whole town turned out. Escorting the Queen was Vickers Armstrong Chairman Sir Charles Dunphy. Significantly, the nuclear submarine was called Dreadnought. That was the name of the first battleship of the modern era. The battleships have passed, and Dreadnought, with Commander Sanborn as captain, will be part of an underwater fleet securing the free world, fantastically to be defended from the ocean depths. Defense Chief Earl Mountbatten was with the launching party. 3,500 tons of submarine costing £20 million, Dreadnought was dispatched to its proper element by Her Majesty the Queen.
I name this ship Dreadnought. May God bless her and all who serve in her.
Of Westminster awaited the arrival of Her Majesty the Queen. Escorted by the household cavalry, the Queen and Duke rode in the Irish coach from Buckingham Palace. This is the established pattern of the royal arrival on this state occasion. Centuries have passed since the monarch rode to Westminster to give instructions to his legislators. In the constitutional monarchy of today, the sovereign takes no part in framing the legislative program. But the opening of Parliament retains the grandeur that has invested it for centuries. Anomalously, by withdrawing from all controversial affairs of government, the monarchy has strengthened its hold upon the affections of the people. Now time for the Lord Great Chamberlain to convey the imperial crown to the royal robing room. The whole ceremonial of the state opening is performed with measured dignity, befitting its long and honored tradition. The distinguished company in the chamber of the House of Lords rose as the Queen entered, slowly proceeding towards the throne from which, for the seventh time in her reign, she was to deliver the royal speech. As always, the legislative program outlined therein was prepared by the government and referred to measures which the ministers proposed to introduce in the forthcoming session.
My lords and members of the House of Commons, I pray that the blessing of Almighty God may rest upon your councils.
The ceremony was now completed. The distinguished company had witnessed one more state opening, the beginning of the second session of the present Parliament. The continuity of democratic government is preserved. It is the privilege of this nation to enjoy the freedom of constitutional monarchy. Effective parliamentary government began at Westminster. It has survived the numerous changes of history and is still a model to the world. And how splendidly Her Majesty becomes her royal office.
1960 was an Olympic year. Pathé brought all the action and thrills of the Rome Games to British audiences and reflected the glory of Britain's gold-winning athletes. Donald Campbell kept up his relentless search for the fastest time on land and sea. And of course, there were familiar events like the Derby. Amid the serious news from around the world, Pathé endeavoured to keep its audiences smiling.
Flora is the prize mother of the Sydney Circus. She's just had her 15th litter, all girls. That makes a total of 70 babies she's had and never claimed a penny in child endowment. That's enough to make any mother look sad. Worth £50 each, the new arrivals get every care. So the first need is a good nanny. And who better than Danny the orangutan? He's a beginner, so excuse his way of finding out if it's the right temperature. Well, a nurse has to know these things if she's going to do the job properly. Danny's got a big surprise coming. He'll be amazed how these babies grow. St. Mark's, North Audley Street, with famous jockey Lester Piggott about to come under starter's orders in the matrimonial stakes. Or should I say handicap? The best man was John Sutcliffe, an assistant trainer. Lester's father contributed to the general racing atmosphere, and the bride was pretty Susan Armstrong, daughter of the popular Newmarket trainer, Sam Armstrong. Lester Piggott was only 14 when he was seen to be on the threshold of genius. He is now 24, and since boyhood he's won two derbies, most of the big races, and hundreds of winners all told. He's lived for racing ever since he can remember. He's a man, now a married man. No racing today, just the reception, then off to the airport to begin the honeymoon in the south of France. He'll be back for the opening of the flat season. Susan, as a trainer's daughter, appreciates that. And Lester, happy as they make 'em, past the post with his own favorite. The most publicized soldier since Napoleon, Elvis Presley, with girlfriend Priscilla Beaulieu to see him off, was leaving Frankfurt at the end of his army service. So it was farewell to military glory and to 16-year-old Priscilla. What fame for that girl to have been a friend of the Emperor of Rock and Roll. At Fort Dix, New Jersey, newsreels, TV, the press, the lot, told the world how... Everybody at Goodwood wished better luck to Stirling Moss, including Rob Walker, whose Cooper Climax used to drive. Tony Brooks was to pilot the Van Wall, a welcome reappearance of that car. The Duke of Kent took pictures as the famous drivers got set for the Goodwood International 100. 42 laps of the 2.4-mile circuit. The fastest cars and the finest drivers in the country. Moss number 7 led, determined to beat the ill luck that dogged him last season. After four laps, Moss was overtaken by number 14, a rear-engine Lotus, the driver Innes Ireland. From then on, Ireland never allowed Moss to pass him, try as he would. Lap after lap, it was Ireland with Moss close behind. Finish. Ireland first, Moss second. The crowd felt that a new motor racing star was born. To 29-year-old Innes Ireland, a Scot, Mrs. Glover presented the Glover Trophy. He won at 100.39 miles an hour, a Goodwood record.
Newsreel history was made on Epsom Downs, the Derby filmed for the first time by PATHÉ News in Technicolor. Everybody, real live dukes, lords galore, plus royalty, pearly king variety. There's no extreme the Derby doesn't justify. From the vantage point of the royal box, knowledgeable eyes were turned on the horses parading along the course. Lester Piggott had some paddy under good control. Arger seemed nervous, but the tragic drama awaiting him was such as not even master film director Alfred Hitchcock could have imagined. Nor did anyone in the near-record crowd know how terrible a fate lay so soon in store for the favorite. Below, the field of 17 gave no trouble at the tapes. This was the moment for which the whole racing world was waiting. The greatest classic of the flat season was about to start. Mr. Alec Marsh appraised the behavior of the field. All 17 were under starter's orders, and without difficulty, he got them away first time. A mile and a half to go, the most exacting test of speed, stamina, and rider's skill in racing. Leading at this stage were Ports and Anne, Oak Ridge, Marengo, Ides of March, Kithnos, and St. Paddy. As they passed bounded down the slope towards Tattenham Corner, the French colt Angers, hot favorite at 2-1, broke a fetlock, though few people were aware of it at the time. The rest raced on. Tudor Period, Die Hard, Oroy, St. Paddy, and Marengo making the running. As they rounded the corner, Die Hard was a shade in front of Tudor Period, with Oroy and St. Paddy well up. It was here that thousands began to wonder what had happened to Angers. And it was here, too, that the real drama of the Derby entered its decisive phase. Furlongs out, Kithnos had a good chance, but Lester Pigott, brilliantly timing his effort and placed third from the rails, took St. Paddy to the front, held off the challenge of Alcius, and began to look like the winner if he could keep up his speed. And maintain it he did. Kithnos was fading. Alcius had no more in reserve. By three lengths, St. Paddy won the Derby. Alcius second, Kithnos third. Battersea Park on a weekday was its usual quiet self. But before long, spy flights detected activity below, and the lake was on the brink of war. It was over the brink, the dreadful truth being that students of Battersea Technological College were holding their annual rag. They aren't satisfied till everybody's been in the drink. Davy Jones's locker, up came the college Neptune, so exhausted he could only stagger ashore. So cold, he needed artificial perspiration. Well, there was nothing cold about the Rock and Roll Championship of Great Britain. 48 enthusiasts from all parts of the country had come to London for the finals after winning their local heats. First prize, £100 and a challenge cup. This is the cat's world, and if the squares don't like it, they can go and jump in that Battersea lake. The pride of Bolton, Eric Winwood and Sherry Bates. The judges agreed that the first prize must go to those Bolton wanderers, Eric and Sherry. Now, whose sideboard will the cup stand on, his or hers? Or are they going to get together?
Wimbledon, Shirley Brasher serving, partnered by Christine Truman in the final match of the Whiteman Cup. In splendid form, Shirley and her partner faced Janet Hopps and Dorothy Knode. This was the deciding match. Till now, it was Britain and America, three matches all. A point now to the Americans. Janet's passing shot was a winner. The Americans lost the first set, and Britain now led 8-7. And here again, it was a point to the United States. Shirley Brasher serving, match point. Out, and Great Britain regain the Whiteman Cup. The Duchess of Devonshire presented the cup to Mrs. Walter, non-playing captain. On the eve of Wimbledon, a wonderful tonic for British tennis. First man out was best man Colin Hicks, and then came his brother, the bridegroom himself, fabulous Tommy Steele. Between 2,000 and 3,000 ecstatic fans gave the rock and roll idol the show business welcome of the year. Tommy Steele was getting married. Except Soho Square, there wasn't a square in sight. There in force was the entertainment world. Army Games' Harry Fowler arrived, and then Andrew Ray and his wife. Sydney James with Ancott. And taking up her share of Soho Square, Hattie Jakes. And now the bride. Tommy's choice was the former Windmill Theatre girl, 23-year-old Anne Donahue. She is a Roman Catholic. And though Tommy isn't, special dispensation had been given for them to marry at St. Patrick's Soho Square. For Anne, it was a white wedding. Father Bebb made them man and wife. It was a friendly marriage service, a blend of the solemn and informal. Tommy and Anne now made their way to the vestry to sign the register. Meanwhile, more fans than ever were pressing round the church door to give a reception such as not even Tommy Steele had known before. That was the first kiss outside the church. It was their big day, and Tommy and Anne were enjoying every second of it. There was no hurry, but if they were going to get away, the Bobbies would have to help. They did. So, it was the Savoy next stop. A proper do and all the trimmings, mate, was what Tommy promised the 300 guests. And Jimmy Edwards and all the rest reveled in the fun. Scores of times they toasted the health and happiness of the newlyweds. And so say all of us. Is this the fastest machine on Earth? We should soon know. It's called Bluebird, of course, because it belongs to Donald Campbell. He's brought it to Goodwood so that we can have a look at the car in which he hopes to capture the world's land speed record. Leo Villa, Campbell's chief engineer, is here too, proudly introducing his 4-ton, 30-foot giant. The wheels are almost as tall as the driver. Engine, a Bristol Siddeley Proteus gas turbine producing 4,250 horsepower. That should take some holding. In fact, to keep her down to 80, you must brake all the time. After trials at Goodwood, Campbell's taking her to Utah Salt Flats for the record attempt. Good luck, Donald. Huddersfield, led by the mayor, said, "Welcome home, Anita Lonsborough." Winner of the gold medal for the Olympic breaststroke event, Anita was heroine of her native town. Her father and mother were with her at the town hall, admiring the handsome medal won in competition with the best swimmers from all over the world. Outside, Anita once more heard the cheers of the thousands who'd turned out in her honor. Huddersfield folk don't let themselves go for nothing, but now they had somebody worth cheering. They put heart and soul into acclaiming Anita Lonsborough. Back to the Olympics themselves. If Anita's success in the breaststroke was expected, only insiders hope for a gold medal for Britain in the 50-kilometre walk. Not exactly a pleasant stroll either in the broiling heat of Rome in a record late summer. Somewhere in that bunch was the 27-year-old insurance clerk from Cranford, Middlesex, Donald Thompson. Still 3 miles to go with the leading walkers in fine fettle. Ljunggren of Sweden left, won 12 years ago, but Don Thompson was now leaving him behind. It didn't look as if the Englishman could possibly lose. It had a special steam bath rigged up at his home, and after daily doses of that, he found the Rome heat almost cool. Lowering the Olympic record by 2.5 minutes, Don won by 60 yards in 4 hours, 25 and a half minutes. A well-won gold medal for Donald Thompson. Everything seemed favorable for Donald Campbell's attack on the world land speed record. His wife was with him, and both they and his devoted team of ace mechanics were optimistic. Not only did they expect to exceed 400 miles an hour, a much higher figure was whispered behind the scenes. Donald himself supervised preparation right up to the last minute. Everything had been done that could be done by the designers and builders of the fabulous million-pound supercar. It was now up to one man, and one man alone, the fearless record seeker himself. On his first run, Campbell was timed at about 300 miles an hour. the return run. As he raced towards the measured mile, he was touching 300, accelerating terrifically. A mile and a half from the start, he was doing 365. A strong crosswind blew the car a little off course into the soft assault. Within seconds, Bluebird was a wreck. Onlookers were horrified. Could Donald Campbell possibly be alive? The miracle was that apparently he was not even seriously hurt. Even his instruments were unbroken. It seems that what saved his life was the safety harness, that and the great strength of the car. Not many hours later, Donald was saying he'd have a Bluebird at Bonneville next year to try again. What an astonishing man Donald Campbell is. It's pleasant in winter to think back to cricket, but there's been a cloud over Lord's. The long room has echoed to the tread of MCC pundits visited by Sir Donald Bradman. Don doesn't lead his men onto the field anymore, but that pre-war bodyline bowling trouble he'll never forget. Not even he knew the answer to the terrifying Larwood, delivering express bumpers with a tight leg-side beat. Cricket recovered from bodyline. Today there's throwing. Will it be banned or tolerated in big cricket next season? For this newsreel, the great Alec Bedser and twin brother Eric illustrated the controversy at Alf Gover's cricket school. No hint of throwing here. Alf Gover explains.
Alec, I'll tell you what we'll do now. We'll show the difference between the legal delivery and the throw. And do you mind? I think we'll have your sweater off for this one.
Watch out, Alf.
Now, here's a man who's taken 236 test match wickets. His delivery has been passed by umpires all over the world. And here is the Alec Bedser legal action. Off we go. Now, watch, the right arm comes down here. When he gets there, it straightens. Comes straight over, and it's still straight when he delivers the ball.
Ordinary bowling offers no special danger to the batsman. Throwing by fast bowlers might mean the death of somebody sooner or later. Now, slowed down, see the bent arm delivery of the thrower.
Now, that was a throw, and it nearly hit Eric.
We all hope there's peace at Lord's and every other ground when the Australians are here next summer. Cricket is sport, not war, hot or cold. Long may it flourish in good sportsmanship.
1960 was a year of growing world tension. It was also a year in which the hopes of the Western Allies found a resting place on the shoulders of a young man from the East Coast of America, John F. Kennedy. One of the century's most eventful and perilous decades was underway. 1960, a year to remember.